good evening, everyone. It's just wonderful to see you. I thought perhaps, I thought the clergy would be here, or at least some of us, but I didn't know that anyone else would be on any of this. So it's great that you're here, and those of you who were here last week will have heard my general introduction, so I'm not going to repeat that. And we're going to pick up where we left off with Bishop Andrew's talk last week, which was with Jesus having entered Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, having gone and had a look at the temple, and then gone back to Bethany where he was staying the night. And so today we pick up on the next section, which is... which we'll come to in a moment. And it's really good to welcome Olivia. I mentioned last week that I've been with Bishop Andrew in Ethiopia. Well, Olivia was also there and had, I think, as good a time as I did. And so that was good. And so let's start with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus and for all that he means to us who try to follow him as best we can. As we learn more about his last week of ministry, help us to deepen our faith, to understand more about your things, the things of your kingdom, the things that Jesus came to model for us and to tell us. And we pray that you'll be with Olivia as she speaks to us this evening, and that each of us will find something to take away with us and to consider in the days ahead. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So I know you've got the words. Did you say that I was going to start off by reading the words? Yeah, I'll read the words, and of course you can follow if you want to. It's worth noting that this is really helpful for the clergy because, by coincidence, next Sunday's Gospel reading is the cleansing of the temple in John's Gospel. So I'm hoping that you're going to inspire us with all kinds of hints for things we can reinforce. Mark chapter 11, beginning at verse 12. On the following day, when they came from Bethany, Jesus was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to see whether perhaps he would find anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And his disciples heard it. Then they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and saying, "Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations'? But you have made it a den of robbers." And when the chief priests and the scribes heard it, they kept looking for a way to kill him. For they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was spellbound by his teaching. When evening came, Jesus and his disciples went out of the city. In the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree withered away to its roots. Then Peter remembered and said to him, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered." Jesus answered them, "Have faith in God. Truly I tell you, if you say to this mountain, 'Be taken up and thrown into the sea,' and if you do not doubt in your heart, but believe that what you say will come to pass, it will be done for you. So I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Whenever you stand praying, forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses." Again, they came to Jerusalem. As he was walking in the temple, the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders came to him and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? Who gave you this authority to do them?" Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. Answer me,
And I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? Answer me. They argued with one another. If we say from heaven, he will say, why then did you not believe him? But shall we say of human origin? They were afraid of the crowd, for all regarded John as truly a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And Jesus said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. Thank you.
John, very much for that introduction, and thank you for inviting me, and actually thank you for organising this lecture series. It's been going for quite some time now, hasn't it?
Well,
one week. No, no, 2 years.
Yes, many years.
Yes,
yes.
Yes.
10 years.
I think it's a fantastic tradition, and I'm delighted to be here again. I was here 2 years ago, I think. Now, there's a danger, of course, in inviting a whole range of different people to come and preach about actually not a very long passage of scripture, because they're all going to come at it in different ways. And so I think I probably need to start with a disclaimer, which is that if I don't produce what you're expecting me to, you'll just have to assume that, you know, my off-piste travels are courtesy of the Spirit. I, of course, don't know what Bishop Andrew talked about last week, and I've got no idea what Julie's going to talk about next week. So I don't know whether this fits or not, but here we are. I'd like us to think together this evening about how Jesus used his authority to subvert the dominant system of his time. He did this all through his ministry, but it was particularly focused into this last week of his life. And then when I've done that, I'd like to think together with you about what the dominant systems of our time are and how we might use our voice and our Christian understanding to subvert them. And in order to understand the context in which the central act of this passage from Mark is placed, we need to understand what was going on around it. So you may find that you get a little reprise of last week. In the spring of the year 30, Jesus journeyed to Jerusalem in the season of Passover. Jerusalem was the traditional religious and political capital of the Jewish homeland. It was also the centre of the domination system. Now, domination systems are as old as human society is, and they've been the norm right up until the advent of various sorts of democracy have been introduced and have softened them somewhat. They're generally marked by three major features. First, they're marked by political oppression. Ordinary people have no voice in shaping the society. The many are ruled by the few powerful, wealthy elites. The second feature of a domination system is economic exploitation. Most of the wealth in those days came from agricultural production, and it went straight into the coffers of the wealthy and the powerful through various structures, laws of land ownership, taxation, indentured labour, and so on. And the third feature is religious legitimation. So all of this system was legitimised in religious language. Those features you'll find in any domination system, you know, since human beings first settled down. Think about England in feudal times and up until quite recently, and you'll see exactly the same thing. Feudal overlords, who have the power of life and death over their underlings and their serfs. All of the land belongs to the overlords, and the peasants pay their allegiance in crops. And this is the way that God intended it to be. You've got the divine right of kings. As the redoubtable Mrs. Alexander put it in the mid-19th century, the rich man in his castle, the poor man at his gate, he made them high or lowly and ordered their estate. Absolutely standard. Let's travel back to the first century in the Middle East. Along came Jesus into this system, following generations of outspoken Jewish prophets to announce that this was actually not how God intended it to be. Now, Jerusalem had become, over the centuries, the centre of injustice and the betrayal of God's covenant with his people. God's passion for justice permeates the Old Testament, and it had been replaced by human injustice. At the time of Jesus' birth, Herod the king was no different from many of his predecessors. He'd been appointed by the Romans. He was profligate in spending, he was brutal in his oppression, and near the end of his reign, he was psychopathically paranoid. After his death, the Romans, perhaps a little disturbed by his unstable mental state, decided that actually this wasn't a safe or sustainable way to rule, so they placed the local administration under the authority of the temple. Now, the temple had always been of great religious importance, and it now became the central economic and political institution in the country. It was the linchpin of the collaboration with the Roman Empire. So the temple had become both a symbol of and an executor of the domination system. Do you see how that works? Mark's terminology for the temple authorities is, he calls them the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes. That phrase recurs several times. So you have the chief priests, who came from the high-ranking priestly families. The elders were from wealthy lay families. And the scribes associated with them were a whole literate class who worked as legal experts, record keepers, administrators, that sort of thing. And you also have the Pharisees, who were a sect known for their strict observance of the rules, and the Sadducees, who were a more conservative sect than them. The Sadducees accepted only the Torah, the five books of the Mosaic Law, whereas most Jews would accept the teaching of the prophets in addition to that. It was the season of Passover. Now, Passover was the most important of the annual festivals, when the city was most crowded with pilgrims from all over the Jewish world. So thousands and thousands of people had poured into the city who weren't normally there. And with a group of followers, Jesus, a Jewish mystic who was a healer, a wisdom teacher, and a social prophet, arrived in the city about a week before the day of Passover itself. Two processions entered Jerusalem that day. One was a peasant procession, and the other was an imperial procession. As Mark tells the story, and you heard it last week, Jesus rode into Jerusalem from the east, down from the Mount of Olives, on a donkey. His followers chanted words that linked his entry with the kingdom of David, the greatest of the ancient kings of Israel. Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. So a longing for a return to times before all of this exploitation, times of justice, times of social compassion, a different age they were harking back to. Jesus came from the peasant village of Nazareth. His message was about the kingdom of God, and his followers came from the peasant classes. They journeyed to Jerusalem from Galilee, about 100 miles to the north. So here they are coming into the city from the east. At approximately the same time, on the same day, the Roman governor, Pilate, proclaiming the power of empire, would have been entering Jerusalem from the west at the head of a squadron of imperial Roman cavalry and soldiers. So do you see what's going on here? It looks as though a direct confrontation between two completely different systems is about to happen. These two processions embody the central conflict of the week that led to Jesus' crucifixion. Pilate's military procession was a demonstration of both Roman imperial power and Roman imperial theology. It would have been a well-known event in the Jewish homeland in the first century. because it was standard practice of the Roman governors of Judea to be in Jerusalem for the major Jewish festivals. Now, this wasn't because they had any kind of empathetic reverence for the religious devotion of the Jewish subjects, but because they were always aware that there might be trouble, and there often was. Passover, after all, was the festival that celebrated the Jewish people's liberation from an earlier empire. Pilate's procession had come up from Caesarea Maritima, which was a huge, modern, all-weather port city about 60 miles to the west, where Pilate lived in splendour. It was a place that was far more congenial to him than Jerusalem, which was inland and insular and often hostile. So imagine the scene. Cavalry, foot soldiers, leather armour, helmets, weapons, banners, golden eagles, marching feet, creaking leather, clinking bridles, beating drums. You can just picture it. And the silence of the onlookers, curious, awed, resentful. The imperial theology which was on display was that the emperor was not just the ruler of Rome, not just the ruler of the entire Roman Empire, but was actually the Son of God. Roman emperors had divine titles. They were worshipped, they were prayed to. There was a very uneasy relationship between the Jewish God, Yahweh, and the Roman emperor. And this is highlighted in the story in Mark 12, when the chief priests and scribes and elders are trying to trap Jesus, and they send some Pharisees to ask him a tricky question about paying taxes. But I expect that's next week's lecture. Jesus' entry on that particular day, the day we call Palm Sunday, was no coincidence. Jesus had planned it in advance, and it deliberately countered what was happening on the other side of the city. So on the one side, you've got the power, the glory, and the violence of the empire that ruled the world, and on the other side, an alternative vision, the kingdom of God. Now, I've spent a bit of time on this because it is the confrontation between these two rival kingdoms which continues right through the week. So Jesus has finally arrived in Jerusalem riding on a donkey to fulfill the Old Testament prophecy. He's been into the city, surrounded by adoring crowds. He's being checked out of the temple, and then because it's nearly sunset, he goes down to the nearby village of Bethany to spend the night with his friends. And then Mark relates two stories, and we have to ask what they mean and why they're together. The next morning, Jesus leaves the house of Mary and Martha and heads back to Jerusalem. As he's walking along the road with his 12 companions, he spots a fig tree some way off in a field. He walks over it to see if there's any fruit on it, which is very odd because it wasn't the season for fruiting. He can't really or reasonably have expected there to be any figs on it, but very unreasonably, it seems, he curses it. So if we just look at the text, this is verses 12 to 14. On the following day, when they came from Bethany, he, Jesus, was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to see whether perhaps he would find anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season of figs. He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And the disciples heard it. The following morning, when the group is doing the same journey again from their overnight lodging in Bethany, Peter spots that the fig tree has withered, which again is very surprising, because to wither overnight for a tree which the day before had leaves on it is not natural tree behaviour. So verse 20, in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree withered away to its roots. Then Peter remembered and said to him, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered." And then Jesus responds. Now, these two bits of the fig tree story frame the account of Jesus on the Monday turning over the tables in the temple. Then they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he wouldn't allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. Now, what Jesus is engaged with during this last week of his life is an out-and-out proclamation in word and action of the already present kingdom of God. It's a kingdom which stands against both the imperial power and the Jewish collaboration with it. It's an absolute criticism not only of the violent domination, but of any part that religion plays in it. It's a real serious critique of the temple. Jesus stands in the same line as the prophets of Israel, like Zechariah and Jeremiah, and he also stands against those forms of Christianity which have been used throughout the centuries to support violence and injustice. So we find Jesus speaking and acting with an authority which presents a huge challenge to the religious leaders. The temple authorities and their associates challenge Jesus then with a series of questions which are intended to discredit him in the presence of the huge crowd of pilgrims which is thronging the outer courts of the temple. The first question is about his authority. So again, they came to Jerusalem. As he was walking in the temple, the chief priests, the scribes and the elders came to him and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? Who gave you this authority to do them?" Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. Answer me, and I'll tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? Answer me." They argued with one another. "If we say from heaven, he'll say, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But shall we say of human origin?" They were afraid of the crowd, for all regarded John as a true prophet. So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." And Jesus said to them, "Well, neither will I tell you by what authority I'm doing these things." Did John the Baptist's authority to baptize come from heaven, or was it of human origin? His question puts them on the defensive. They confer. Either response will discredit them. If they say from heaven, it'll open them up to the charge of hypocrisy. If they say of human origin, they risk turning the crowd with whom John the Baptist has been immensely popular against them. So they grind their teeth and say, "We don't know." And keeping his end of the bargain, Jesus refuses to answer their question. This interesting framing that Mark does of the temple story, the turning over of tables in the temple, framed either side by that story of the fig tree, is really designed to show us what Jesus was about, what he was doing. And what he was doing was launching a full frontal attack. And the story of the fig tree, which is a ridiculous story, it's totally unreasonable on all counts, actually is written there by Mark in order to help us to understand that Jesus, by word and action, was doing something different from what it looked as if he was doing. So the turning over of the tables in the temple actually wasn't about, I don't think, his disgust at the commerce that was going on. It was his disgust at the economic exploitation and the political domination which the temple authorities had taken on. And that story about the fig tree was simply to say, "A curse upon you." And very interestingly, framed into that sort of picture in the middle of this bit of Mark's Gospel. So Jesus here is using his authority in word and action in order to confront. And throughout this week, his challenge to the authorities continues, and with each exchange, he confounds them and he delights the crowd. This takes us back to Mark chapter 1, where we find Jesus in Capernaum teaching in the synagogue. And it says, "And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes." We've seen him use his authority on many different occasions as we followed his itinerant ministry in Galilee and the neighbouring areas. There was the time when he healed the man with the withered hand in the synagogue on the Sabbath, which is related in Mark chapter 3. It says, "Again he entered the synagogue, and a man was there with a withered hand. And they watched Jesus to see whether he would heal him on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man with the withered hand, 'Come here.' And he said to them, 'Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do harm, to save a life or to kill?' But they were silent. And he looked around at them with anger, grieved at their hardness of heart, and said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately held counsel with the Herodians against him, how to destroy him." So they recognised his authority and they recognised the challenge way back at the beginning of his ministry. And he wasn't winning any friends amongst the religious establishment. We saw in Mark chapter 4, Jesus asleep at the back of a boat, being woken by terrified disciples in a storm. "Teacher, don't you care that we're perishing?" And then Jesus got up and rebuked the wind and the sea. "Silence," he commanded, "be still." And the wind died down, and it was perfectly calm, the voice of authority. In Mark chapter 5, we saw him confronted by a dead child and her grieving parents. "Little one, get up." And she got up from her bed and walked around. And John recounts another great raising from the dead, which Bishop Stephen has been concentrating on during Lent, the story of Lazarus. Jesus says with authority, "Lazarus, come out." And Lazarus, who's been dead for 3 days by then, came out of the tomb. Demons recognised him and were unable to resist his authority over them as he ordered them out of those who were possessed. Jesus has already established his authority by the signs and wonders he's done in the lives of ordinary people. There was no doubt that he had authority. But what he didn't have was power in the domination system. And what he's doing this last week of his life is to use his authority to subvert the domination system of the temple. He wasn't attacking Judaism as a religion. He wasn't attacking the priesthood or the high priesthood. He wasn't even attacking the temple as a location for blood sacrifice. What he was doing was demonstrating by word and action that Jerusalem had to be retaken by a non-violent Messiah rather than by a violent revolution. And the temple ritual had to empower justice rather than excuse one from it. It was an absolute criticism, not only of violent domination, but also any form of religious collaboration with it. And it was done with symbolic acts, acts such as those performed by all of the social prophets in the Hebrew Bible. And so it was a protest against the temple's role in the domination system, and perhaps also a warning of divine judgment against it, hence the fig tree. So we're at this point in the story, on this particular day in the last week of Jesus' life. But both looking back over the previous 3 years and forwards to the next few days, Jesus was telling his contemporaries that the kingdom was breaking into history, but that it didn't look like what they expected it to. The time of restoration was at hand, and people of all sorts were being summoned to share and enjoy it. But Israel was warned that its present ways of advancing the kingdom were counterproductive and were going to end in national disaster. Jesus was calling his hearers to be Israel in a new way, to take up their proper roles in God's unfolding drama, and he assured them that if they followed him in this way, then they would be vindicated when the great day came. Jesus was launching the real battle for the kingdom. Jesus' kingdom announcement would lead to the victory through which Israel's God would become king. But this victory and the resulting kingdom would not look like what Jesus' contemporaries had in mind. It was being initiated in and through Jesus' own work. His ministry and his message were highly subversive of the domination system of his time, and they still are. So let's now turn to our own times. I want now to think about our technological age, and in particular, about the way in which technology has come to dominate our lives. Big tech, by which I mean primarily Google, Amazon, Facebook, and Apple. Anybody here not heard of any of those things? Okay, so we know what we're talking about. Big tech considers that the concentration of power in its companies and the networks they control is an urgent social good. Does that surprise you? They think of it as a precursor to global harmony and a necessary condition for undoing the alienation of humankind. This sounds amazing. It sounds groundbreaking. It's visionary stuff. It sounds a little bit like the breaking in of the kingdom of God. But is it? Could this be another kind of domination system? Let's think again about what the elements of a domination system are. Political. Ordinary people having no voice in the shaping. The many ruled by the few powerful, wealthy elites. Economic. Most of the wealth going into the coffers of the wealthy and powerful. Religious. All of this framed in religious, moral, ethical language. Now, it probably all started back in the 60s. Anybody here remember the 60s? Let me remind you. Society was changing very fast in the 60s. The US was a nation sickened by the Vietnam War and by a political class which seemed hell-bent on world domination by nuclear weaponry. Rapacious industrial monopolists were hell-bent on dominating markets right across the world. And there in the US, a whole generation of young people were longing for and dreaming of a society in which there was peace and love, cosmic consciousness, and a counterculture which challenged the dominant political and economic paradigm. We saw the advent of the Summer of Love, the Whole Earth Catalogue, Haight-Ashbury, a generation on mind-altering substances, the Grateful Dead and Janis Joplin. Arlo Guthrie sang Alice's Restaurant and draft cards were burned. Communes were set up and the quest for community and wholeness caught fire. As the age of electric technology gave way to the digital tech age, Marshall McLuhan predicted a brave new world. Today, we have extended our central nervous system itself in a global embrace, abolishing both space and time as far as our planet is concerned. High rhetoric. McLuhan hinted that this network had the potential to wrap like a magical bandage around the whole world, closing up its wounds. Now, this was powerful language for a generation born in the shadow of a total war and living under the constant threat of nuclear conflagration. The healing powers of tech could be found in McLuhan's most famous maxim, "The medium is the message." McLuhan longed for a world before print. He longed for oral culture and face-to-face interactions. The perfect tech would revive the spirit of that, but on a planetary scale, transforming the world into one big happy tribe, a global village, a place of warmth and relationship. Every single significant technological development since has come wrapped up in McLuhan's aspiration for machines to usher in a new era of cooperation and an end to social isolation. It was exactly how Tim Berners-Lee described the possibilities for the World Wide Web that he created. It's fueled a succession of grand collaborative projects. There's been Wikipedia, the Creative Commons, open source software, and all sorts of others. The business plans of the most spectacularly successful firms in human history, Google and Facebook, are all about wiring the world up into one big network where individuals work together in a spirit of altruism to share information. However, human nature remains its familiar self. Each groundbreaking innovation promises to liberate technology from the grip of monopolists and to create a new network so democratic that it will transform human nature. And what happens in every instance is that instead of profound redistributions of power, the new networks are captured by new monopolies, each more powerful and sophisticated than the last one. So the personal computer came to be dominated by a single innovation-inhibiting firm, Microsoft. Access to the internet soon required handing over substantial sums of money to a diminishing number of service providers. One site, Google, has emerged as the portal to all knowledge. Another site, Amazon, has emerged as the starting point for all commerce. And although we still talk about social networks in the plural, the reality is that one social medium, Facebook, encompasses nearly 2 billion users. You heard that right, 2 billion users. In Silicon Valley, monopoly seems to be the natural desirable order of things. That's why startup tech companies no longer dream of displacing Google or Facebook. They launch themselves with the ultimate aspiration of getting bought up by them. Google has acquired 200 companies over the last few years, including Android and YouTube, and many that you won't have heard of, but whose influence you will be feeling in your life. And there's a coziness in the relationships between these giants. Google pays $1 billion a year so that Apple will use its search engine. They share board members. So do we have a new domination system? I think maybe we do. It controls us in many different ways, but over time, it's controlling and generally narrowing the information we look at and the decisions we make. The decisions which are made about us, our access to news and political thought, our ability to consider broadly and to exercise moral judgment. And to see how all this happens, we need to understand something about algorithms. You still with me? At their heart, algorithms are simply tools that learn from large swathes of data, enormous swathes of data. And they provide some sort of optimized response, like a rank or a rating, in line with a pre-programmed procedure. The most familiar is probably experienced when we do a Google search and Google's algorithm decides which 10 sites are going to appear on its front page. Now, algorithms have got a reputation for being infallible and neutral and fundamentally fairer than humans, and as a result, they're quickly being relied on both commercially and in public sector decision-making. We are already far more reliant on algorithmic decision-making than most people realise. Algorithms are already being used in everything from sifting job applications and calculating credit scores to, in the US, deciding which prisoner should spend how long in jail. That last example is particularly chilling because the way that algorithms work is to base their decisions on the data that's been assimilated by them. And if the assimilated data in that case has indicated that black people spend longer in jail than white people do, which is the case in the United States up until now. It's not fair, but it's the way it is. So when they're making parole decisions for prisoners, and it's done by algorithm, black prisoners will not get parole as quickly as white prisoners. Interesting. So the implications of delegating our decisions to these tools range from perpetuating fake news and conspiracy theories to unfairly lengthening prison sentences for minority groups. They are not neutral, fair, all-knowing decision tools. Algorithms function, as I said, by drawing on a huge bank of past data, whilst also influencing real-life decisions, which makes them prone by their very nature to repeat human mistakes and perpetuate them through feedback loops. And often the implications are unexpected and unintended. So let's just have a quick think about Google. Google acts as an index to the information which is out there on the internet. There's far too much of it. And so we need a tool to help us to access what we're looking for. So far, so good. Around 3.6 million searches are made through Google every minute. That's about 3.5 billion every day. Google tells us what to think, what to buy, what to believe. Google co-founder Sergey Brin once said, "The perfect search engine would be the mind of God." Interesting language. But while Google's uncanny ability to regularly find exactly what it is we're looking for may seem to be divine, in reality, even the most sophisticated uses of machine learning have already run into a wall of human fallibility and immorality. When Google responds to a query, it considers a huge variety of metrics in order to ultimately decide which web pages to include, prioritize, and which to exclude. At times, this can cough up highly questionable results. For example, for some time, Google's algorithm responded to the query, did the Holocaust happen, with a series of pages denying the Holocaust. The first of which was a page by a neo-Nazi site entitled Top 10 Reasons Why the Holocaust Didn't Happen. Yesterday, I Googled, is climate change a hoax? The first suggestion that came up was a tweet by one Donald Trump, which said the concept of global warming was created by and for the Chinese in order to make US manufacturers non-competitive. Try Googling, is being gay a sin? 10 sites will appear on the front page. Take out the two which refer to Tim Farron's difficulties and the Wikipedia entry, and you're left with 7. Those 7 sites suggest that it is a sin. Now, whatever your own thinking on this issue, we all realise that there is more than one view here. And now imagine that you're a young person who's coming to terms with their homosexuality or that of a friend or sibling and is looking for information. Google not only analyses our behavior and our views, it shapes them. Google knows there's a problem here. Last year, Google released a blog post acknowledging its role in the proliferation of fake news, hoaxes, unsupported conspiracy theories, and offensive content. Google may have little control over the existence of problematic content on the web, but it does control the information its algorithm pays attention to. But how it does this is not open to scrutiny. And the secretive nature of algorithms means that people can't scrutinise the decisions made. Facebook's algorithm contains 60 million lines of code. And it's used to winnow down all the possible information it accesses through its 2 billion users into a small bespoke batch for each user, which is ordered by what that person might like to see first. As with Google, it's only in retrospect that people notice when questionable results start to crop up. For instance, it only recently emerged that Facebook's algorithm-based advertising feature enabled advertisers to specifically target anti-Semites. Overnight, it's over time it's become apparent that LinkedIn's algorithms suggest male names more frequently than female names. The other place that all this leads to is the creation of artificial intelligence, AI. Now, this is a huge subject, and we haven't got time to cover it this evening, but there are some great books and articles out there. You can find them on Google and Amazon. Google has a whole research program dedicated to researching artificial general intelligence. As part of this, it's acquired a London-based company called DeepMind, which created neural networks that taught themselves without any human instruction to play video games. You can see where this is going, and it's quite chilling. There's very good evidence that AI and social media used together are shaping the democratic process and changing the nature of public debate. Technology is partly responsible for the unexpected outcomes of elections and referenda in recent years. We listen and debate in silos. We develop groupthink. We are susceptible to the herd mentality. All of this is leading to sharper, more antagonistic and polarised debate. So there are some very powerful challenges for our world from this particular domination system. We know that we can't reverse it. There is major disruptive change on the way. We don't know the speed or the impact of it, but we had better believe it. Public awareness, debate and scrutiny is really important so that we can live well with new technology, so that we can protect our data and identity and that of our children and grandchildren, and ensure that technology serves us well. All of this is going to affect jobs and education, training and trade. There's a danger that it will increase inequality. We will need joined up ethical, visionary leadership in all sectors, political, economic and religious, to negotiate the future. Because tech brings with it both huge potential for good and huge potential for significant harm. Now, some of you may be sitting there wondering, what on earth has this got to do with Jesus cursing a fig tree? Well, I think that every age has got a domination system of some kind. And in every age, the kingdom of God is breaking in. The task of Christians down the ages has been to announce and enact the kingdom of God with authority wherever and whenever they find themselves. In our age, we're being brought up against some pretty extraordinary questions which have never been asked before. We have evidence of a new type of domination system which is shaping our lives in ways that are not always apparent, and which has the potential to reduce us to being less than fully human, or restrict our potential for becoming all that we can be. What does it mean to be human in a world where machines can make decisions for us, where machines can predict our choices and anticipate our desires and replicate our actions? Our faith has profound things to say about human identity. And a key part of being human from a Christian perspective is understanding that we are all part of creation, but that we all have the power to create. That we are all responsible for our own behaviour, that we all have the choice between good and evil. So here are some thoughts. We need to understand both our limits and our potential. The tech revolution encourages us to dream dreams, but it doesn't encourage us to set boundaries. How do we use our faith perspective to help society to set boundaries? How do we use it to help society to bring ethics into commercial debate, to keep human beings and the rest of creation at the centre, not pushed to the periphery? We need to continually emphasise the importance of truth, of faithfulness, of equality, of respect for individuals, of deep wisdom, and the insights which come from human discourse and the whole ethical tradition, which is deeply rooted in Christianity and in other faiths. We need to be alert to increasing inequality and poverty of opportunity. The indications are already clear. Without intervention, AI is more likely to increase inequality very significantly rather than to decrease it. AI needs to be held within a vision for global economics and politics which is deeper and better than free market capitalism. There's immense potential for good in artificial intelligence, but also immense potential for harm. Let's not be Luddites about any of this. It won't do us any good. In some ways, our lives and the lives of many people will be improved immeasurably by technology. But serious damage can result from the wrong use of it, and lives can be distorted. Machines can and will be sexualized, which will shape the humanity of those who use them. Weaponization of artificial intelligence needs very careful international debate and global restraint. It's coming over the hill. In our daily lives, we may be in a position to influence the way in which our society interacts with big tech and with artificial intelligence. So let's use whatever influence we have, wherever we have it, to question, to challenge, to insist on the primacy of education and ethical behaviour. And we have individual choice in the way we live and the way we engage with technology. Let's be intelligent about understanding the implication of innovations. Let's not blindly adopt the next bright, shiny thing which is being marketed. Let's think about the amount of time we spend looking at a screen and be selective about what we're looking at. Let's not leave all the decisions to algorithms, but probe and dig and look beyond and use other sources of information. Let's deliberately listen to those we don't agree with and try to understand why they hold the views that they hold. Any time that we prioritise face-to-face contact or even telephone contact over online contact, every time we prioritise real friendships over virtual ones, every time we speak of the primacy of love and act in loving and kind ways, every time we act with compassion and notice who is and who isn't benefiting from the change which is around us, then we're helping to build the kingdom of God. Jesus challenged the domination system of his time, and in doing so, he challenges the domination systems of every time and age. The kingdom of God is always breaking into every part of the world. The kingdom of God is breaking in through people of faith, through people who follow the way of Jesus, through people who follow the way of peace of any faith or no faith. There are plenty of people of peace in the world. We may feel powerless. Jesus probably felt powerless in that last week of his life, in the face of the might of the Roman Empire and its stitch-up with the temple authorities. But he was countercultural and subversive. And we can do that too. The ultimate subversive activity is to be contemplative, to be rooted and grounded in God, to be reflective rather than unthinking, to be curious rather than automatic, to be humorous and loving. Machines can't do that. And to be fully human, to live our lives to the full as the extraordinary creation of God's imaginative love. We can do this. Join me. Thank you for listening. If you're interested, I've drawn heavily on two books as I prepared this talk. Marcus Borg's book that he wrote with John Dominic Crossan, which is called The Last Week. And the other book is a book by Franklin Foer called World Without Mind, The Existential Threat of Big Tech. So almost all of the thought in that lecture is not my own. Bishop Stephen, you may know, speaks on artificial intelligence in the House of Lords, and he's blogged about it, and one of his blog posts is available on the Diocesan website if you're interested. So, I've probably stunned you into bored silence. I'm just wondering whether you might like to stand up, stretch your legs, and take a comfort break if you need it, and then maybe just to find one or two people to chat with and see what you thought of all of that. Process it a bit. Is it okay? Should we take sort of 5-10 minutes to do that?
Helpful if you could use it, especially for those people who need the loop system. So just put your hand up if you've got something to say, and I'll bring the microphone.
I'd be really interested to know what you think about all that.
I know I'm not the brightest one in the world, but I still don't understand the story of the fig tree. I find it perplexing. Why? What was he trying to explain with killing a good tree, which would have produced fruit eventually? I just don't understand. Sorry.
I probably didn't explain very well. And that take on it is something which Marcus Bork has suggested. It's a very curious story, the fig tree. I mean, why? Doesn't make any sense at all. Why would you get cross with a tree for not having fruit when it's the wrong time of the year? It doesn't, you know, it doesn't make any sense. And because it doesn't make any sense, then the idea is that it must mean something else. It wasn't about the tree. It wasn't because Jesus was cross because he was hungry and he just, you know, threw a paddy. There was something else there. So the suggestion is that it was symbolic, and what it was symbolic of was the destruction of the temple. Now, he wasn't calling on destruction on the Jewish religion, but the temple had actually put itself in a position by its collaboration with the Roman Empire, and the part that it now played in the oppression of the Jewish people. That it had put itself outside of what could be considered to be good and holy. So he cursed the fig tree. He went into the temple and said the words and did the actions which showed that he really was very disapproving of what was happening.
So the temple was the fig tree.
The temple was the fig tree. Yeah. So, you know, he was making a very strong statement about in his actions about his disapproval of the economic exploitation that was going on.
Thank you. Also, within this whole passage, there's this verse 20 onwards. That's quite a massive section as well, isn't it? About asking God for his ever and the way that you pray. So there's an awful lot in this whole reading when you think about it.
There is a lot, yes, there is a lot.
The fig tree thing,
oh,
that
the fig tree.
Kind of, yeah. But this thing about, you know, asking God, you know.
Well,
don't doubt.
Rabbi, ask. Look, the fig tree that he curses with, Jesus answered him, have faith in God.
Yeah. Mm.
Don't have faith in the temple. Actually, remember what this is all about. It's about having faith in God. It's about the relationship with the Father. It's not about all of the trappings of religion that are going on in the city. So
it's quite a big statement that's just thrown in with all that.
Yeah. You don't have to agree with this interpretation, but I think it's an interesting one.
Thank you, Olivia. I really enjoyed your talk. I just wonder how you set boundaries yourself so you're not ruled by algorithms.
Well, I dare say that I am ruled by algorithms, just like a lot of the rest of us. When I do a Google search for something, I very often try and look at pages 2, 3, and 4. I try to look beyond what Google wants me to look at. It's a minor protest, I know, but it's a really interesting one. One of the things I find is that not only ruled by algorithms, but the whole existence of this technological invasion of my world means that my attention is very largely fragmented. During the day. So I can sit at my computer doing something, but unless I have actually set my computer up so that it won't disturb me, I get bombarded with this and that, and reminders, calendar things, and then emails that have come in, and whatever. And the temptation to be distracted from the thing I'm trying to think about, or write, or even pray about, and pay attention to the thing that's actually shouting the loudest and the most immediately, is really strong. So I think there is a discipline in all of this, and I'm not good at it, but I'm working on it, which is to try and pay attention to one thing at a time. Pay attention to the thing which you have decided to pay attention to, or to the person you've decided to be with, and then try not to be distracted.
I think you need to turn all your notifications off.
No, exactly, that's what I said. Because I'm very careful.
And if you do that, that annoys Google and everybody else. Because and then you just get on with your life. Yeah. If you leave your notifications on, you're distracted every 2 seconds.
I have to say that I'm not on Facebook. I do have a Facebook account, but that's only because I wanted to see my daughter's wedding photographs.
That's the same thing.
But I never use it, I've absolutely no idea. And Kate, I'm always getting sort of things saying, will you be so-and-so's friend? I just ignore all that. But I do use Twitter. Yeah.
I thought the artificial intelligence stuff absolutely fascinating. I've got two particular interests in it, one in my professional life in the police, and the other, I suppose, in a voluntary capacity as a school governor. Because what we're seeing is the uncoupling of intelligence from consciousness, and that will happen increasingly. And I'm concerned as to how that relates to the allocation of resources. If you take the police, for example, as resources might be allocated according to where there is greatest numerical need, that might mean lots of officers and lots of attentions in high crime areas, but it's unlikely to allocate resources to a grieving victim or one person who's particularly vulnerable, for example. The same might apply in schools, where the greatest good for the greatest number might be a certain amount of results, but not necessarily for the child more needy. So as machines become more advanced, I know that there are ethicists working on how to incorporate into this decision-making the sorts of values that we hold dear. So one of the things which we can practically do is be very certain as to what values we have, what values we espouse, and to argue very strongly for those to be incorporated into the algorithms which increasingly govern our lives in order that they make their decisions not just for efficiency, but also according to need.
Absolutely spot on. Thank you for saying that. I think that it, at the beginning there was this whole sort of revolution was born, as I tried to show, out of idealism, but as it developed, it was referring back to that sort of that idealistic dream of uniting the world, but actually didn't reference ethics at all, as far as I can see. And now we're really starting to realise as a human society that if we don't do that, we're heading very quickly into a subhuman world. That's really, really important. Of course, the whole thing about allocating to, you know, numerically to the greatest need, the whole thing about decision making without reference to the plight of a human individual is not new, because you know, economic theory for decades has done the same thing. General equilibrium theory worked in exactly the same way, and that's why if you leave economics just to the activities of the so-called free market, then you don't get a distribution of resources which actually benefits the people who are the most needy in society. So it's an extension of the same type of thing, and you know, there in the same way, eventually, you know, ethics fed into economic decision making. But this is happening much, much faster.
Well, and still more dangerous, I mean, the public services, because it's linked to votes.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yes.
So it'll become even easier to identify where the marginal gains might be.
Yeah.
Could I ask you about subversion and the church? You talk about Jesus being subversive, and I always thought that was exactly what he was in so many different ways, but particularly in relation to the religion, the Jewish religion of his time. And yet we're all, I think, part of a church which is part of the established order, one way or another. And the church has not been very responsive to subversives within its own midst. What's the kind of reconciliation of that? Should the bishops in the House of Lords just say, well, we don't want any of this, we'll leave you, you can have the places? Because I don't think anybody's actually said that, have they?
No, that's an interesting question, and relating it to the previous comment, actually, there's always a decision to be made about where you can have the maximum impact for good, isn't there? If the bishops were to leave the House of Lords, then who would be speaking for ethics in the decision-making around, for example, the debates on artificial intelligence? Bishop Stephen speaks in the Lords on the subject of artificial intelligence, and has made himself quite an expert on it, because you know, he needed to understand it in order to be able to speak out of a faith perspective in that public square, to be able to bring the Christian perspective to where it can be heard. And it's no good, I don't think, the bishops walking out of the House of Lords and saying, you know, a plague on you, get on with it, and good luck to you, and then going and sitting in their... where do bishops live? Sitting in their houses, in their studies, you know, being holy and, you know, not doing what bishops are supposed to do. I think it's absolutely the responsibility of the church to be subversive in what it says, to be prophetic in what it says and the way that it acts in all the forums in which it's got access.
So, well, looking after its own interests, unfortunately, at the same time. It's an impossible question.
It is an yes.
But it's a question which isn't frequently explored in any of those terms. It doesn't bring it back to Jesus and John the Baptist.
But you know, I think the church inhabits multiple identities. The church started off as a movement, and then it became organised. It became an organisation. And eventually, the structures got solidified. It became an institution that carried the norms from one generation through to the next. And then, every so often, you've had it spinning off and becoming a movement again. And where you get bits of the church becoming prophetic again, which it's done throughout the centuries in different ways, then I think you've got a sort of, you know, you get areas of renewal and impact and all sorts of stuff, which is really exciting. But it does, the church does have this extraordinary ability to inhabit several different personas at the same time. You know, it can be, you know, the institution, it can be sort of aligned with the establishment, it can do the kind of coronation thing really well, all of that. And at the moment, the church is very interested in being an organisation. And there's an awful lot of stuff coming at the church from outside that's forming it into being an organisation. Things like, you know, insistence on the way that we do our employment stuff, HR policies and procedures, all the stuff about safeguarding, quite likely, you know, it's all got to be absolutely, you know, you've got to make sure that it's all in place, and organisationally you are beyond reproach. We're not, unfortunately. And so you've got, you've already got two different identities, and you've always got the bits of the church that are on the front edge, that are inhabiting this much more fluid, perhaps spirit-filled, perhaps prophetic identity as something else that's much more inspired, let's say, spirit-filled, spirit-driven.
I think we're probably running out of questions, so it would be nice to let Olivia get home to West Berkshire. I do think it's wonderful that we have an archdeacon who, along with all the legal responsibilities that an archdeacon has, is capable of bringing such wisdom and interesting analysis of a single passage of Scripture. I think it's beyond what I expected, both last week and this week. But it's right up in what I might just have hoped for. So thank you for putting all that work in. Come on. In a moment, if that's all right, I'll ask you if you'll say a prayer to send us on our way. But I have got one or two other notices. First of which was pressed upon me earlier, and that is to remind you or to tell you that on Saturday of this week there is, and this is really from the sublime to the ridiculous, really, on Saturday of this week there is a Sound of Music sing-along. 4 o'clock here. Richard is holding up a visual aid. So if you hadn't thought of coming along, please do. There are still tickets available. And perhaps more to the sublime, Olivia, along with Bishop Andrew, will be in the parish again next Monday for Tonya's welcome service at St. Eligius at 7:30 in the evening. So, again, if you would like to come to that, that promises to be really exciting because there's a band coming, and it'll be very fun, I think. So next week, we've got Canon Julie on controversy. It's kind of stirring up trouble in the nicest possible way. So that will be excellent. And just by normal thing, there is a basket on the table outside. If you wanted to make a donation towards expenses, that would be gratefully received. Otherwise, we look forward, if you're able to come, to seeing you next week or one of the subsequent weeks. So would you mind?
Of course. So should we just keep a moment of quiet together? And remember our humanity. And remember that we are, because we are loved by God. Almighty and gracious God, we know that we live in a time which is perplexing. We know we live in a time which has potential threat in it to our ability to be human creatures. We ask you to encourage us and fill us with your power, your inspiration, your compassion, and your love as we go from here renewed by your presence with us to make a difference to our world. And we do this because we love you and because you love us and all that you have created. So, Father, help us this night and always to be most fully the person that you have intended us to be. We ask you to bless us now and all those we love and care for. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.